Ah, you should hear me now, right? Thanks. So again, I'm Dimitar, I'm working for SAP, contributing to the MultiApps project, and we're talking about workload deployments in CloudFoundry, Kubernetes, and generally how we should do this. And let's start with a cached question. How do we deploy our workloads in CloudFoundry? And the answer is, well, pretty straightforward. We do it with cfpush. And cfpush is a pretty good tool. It has a very streamlined interface. It does a lot of stuff in the background. It hides all that complexity. Overall, provides a great experience. Well, in the real world, we don't only manage our applications. We have to take care, of course, for creating backing services, updating backing services, handling routes, running tasks, etc. But CloudFoundry, then the CFCLI out of the box provide us with quite powerful tools about doing those tasks. So, what do we do with those tools? Well, we script them, right? This is the easiest thing to do. We choose a language of our own, be it Bash, Python, Ruby, whatever, put it inside the container, put it inside a pipeline, and we're rolling continuously. And this is a decent solution for most projects, but at least I can share from my experience for some projects, things can get a little messy, as those scripts tend to grow with the growing complexity of your product, the growing number of backing services, the number of environments your product gets deployed to. Those scripts get to become heavier, longer. They get to have a lot of ifs and elses. They start to handle failures, start to implement resilience. At the end, you end up with owning a solution which is managing the lifecycle of your actual solution. And well, writing so much boilerplate code, at least for me, it's not fun. And I know I can do better. I know we can do better about this. So what we can do instead of scripting? Well, we can declare our deployments. Instead of imperatively telling the platform what to do, we can declare in a document how our solution should look like declaratively in the form of text, in the form of a static model. And just then give that declaration to a tooling which knows how to create all that stuff. So this allows us to track how our application is evolving, to very easily add additional components of our solution, to even place this in a source control and see the history alongside its versions. And to be honest, cfpush kind of also has us covered on that one. You can use cfmanifests to do that, and cfmanifests are pretty powerful. They handle a lot of applications, a lot of routes. They can do service bindings. They handle all the application attributes, more than 10 of them, like the stacks, the memory, the instances, etc. Well, for some, the story might end here, but I want to, with you now, to explore in more depth what it would mean to have a declarative solution, a declarative model for the whole solution on a platform, including all those additional things we had to do imperatively, like the service instances, the tasks, etc. And we'll do so in the context of an example, a realistic example application. So here we have a simple application with three processes consuming two backing services. Starting from the bottom, we have a DB application. Its responsibility is solely to initialize and take care of the database, like tables, initial content, update those entities, sequences, etc. So it's consuming a backing service, a database, of course. Next process would be a backend application, in our case written in Java. It's consuming the same database and is consuming a UA service to outsource the management of user scopes, etc. And on the top, we have a UI application. That application is delegating calls to the backend application. It's serving some static HTML and JavaScript and consuming also the UA service in order to do some initial filtering. So, having that application, I want to now introduce you to the MultiApps project. So, in a nutshell, the MultiApps project does deploys, updates, and then deploys of CloudFoundry workloads. Those workloads have to be described in the MultiApps model. And what you expect from the MultiApps project, what you can expect from the MultiApps project is repeatable, consistent, fast, and configurable deployments. So, having said enough, let's see how such a description will look like. I'll just switch back to my IDE. you should see it soon. Yeah, here it is. So let's delete that descriptor and build it from scratch. We'll create a new file. This is the source code of my application. Come on, a new file. And it will be called mtad.yaml. That stands for a deployment descriptor of MTA. And let's start by saying what the scheme of that file, so the language version it will be using. It will be using scheme version 3, as the language has somewhat evolved already. It's kind of mature. And while we're talking about versions, let's now set a version to our own application. So let's pick some initial version. Now we can name our solution. Name it product catalog. By the way, the business application will be deploys a business catalog, and you can review other product catalog. You can add and review products there. But yeah, that's not mandatory for the talk. Now let's start declaring the components of our solution. Let's start with the backing services. Usually those are created first and then consumed by the workloads. So in the context of MTAs, the backing services are modeled as resources. And we can start with a generic managed service. So here we declare a resource of type managed service. This means that the deployer will take care and manage that service for you. And via those parameters, we can influence the behavior of the deployer. So we can say, OK, the offering of the service would be HANA, the HANA, SAP HANA database. And the plan would be HDI shared, for instance. And we should give a name of our service. This would be translated to the service instance's name. Why not? Product catalog DB. Now we have another backing service to declare. So let's go jump to it. It would be the UA. I'll spare some time by using a snippet. It's again a managed service from the Access UA offering of one application. And this time there is something new. This time we want to give creation configurations. So those configurations we pass to the service broker when creating that service instance. And such configurations may grow. Here we are only passing the application name, but we can pass roles, scopes, users, etc. It's a really nice feature to export those in an additional file and just reference it here. So that's possible, but for the demo, I won't do that. So we are done with our backing services. Let's see what else we can describe in our model. Let's start with our actual workloads. So workloads in the MTA notation would be described as modules. And let's start with the heart of our application. Let's start with the backend application. So let's do it from scratch. Here is one module. This is a generic structure of module. It has a name. It should be translated to the application's name. The type is application, matching a CloudFoundry application. Let's name it product catalog backend. Here in path, we can relatively show where the content is, basically the bits of that application. So it, for that project, it's in the SRV directory. Properties are, the content of that properties element is actually mapped to a Cloud Foundry application environment variables, and for that module, we won't have any, so we'll skip that. And parameters are the way to influence the behavior of the deployer. We can say, for instance, which stack to use, which build pack to use, which, how much memory we can assign. Since this is a Java application, I guess 2 gigabytes should be fine. Now, that's the next one is kind of interesting. We have the requires element. The requires element is the way to declare a dependency of that module to another resource, and that would be, for instance, a dependency to a backing service. Here we can say we depend on the product catalog UAA and on the product catalog DB as backing services. And this in Cloud Foundry would result in bindings between the backing service and application. And in case you're interested, you can also pass parameters to that binding here. So The last element in, of a module is that provide statement. So this is the mechanism by which modules and resources can share configuration, can share some values in order to get linked on deploy time. You notice that there was no service discovery backing service in the picture. And that's because there is a basic form of service discovery done upon deployment of the application. So now we can say, okay, that when we deploy that application, we want to take its URL and we can get it by a placeholder. Let's say default host and URL. And in another module, we can consume that value, which would be dynamically resolved on deploy time, so that applications know where they are and they can talk to each other. So let's continue with some prepared content in order to spare some time. Here's the product catalog UI. And here it says it has dependency to the backend module. And here is how an environment variable in that application will be created. The environment variable will be, it should be a valid environment variable, backend URL, and it would reference that value from the upper module. Only one module left to declare, and this would be the DB module. And the special thing about that module is that it doesn't need to run as a Cloud Foundry application, as it doesn't need to serve any web requests. So we can say we don't want to start this as an application, and it should not be managed by the platform as an application. We want no route for that application. What we want is only a Cloud Foundry task to be executed. And we can name it, we can say which comment it is, and we can give additional parameters. And this would basically start our application, it will initialize the database, and end. So we are almost done with the modeling of our solution. Only one thing I want to declare last, and that is one additional parameter to the platform. So that parameter is to enable parallel deployment. So having that parameter declared, the deployer would basically create all the applications in parallel, and which would save some time. So now we have our description of our application complete. Let's see what we can do with it. And before we jump to just deploying that application with single command, there is one other powerful tool we can use, actually a whole concept which might change the flow of development to operations, and it is to bundle, that's the code, and it is to bundle our, don't see the slides well. Just a second. Now it should be fine. You can bundle the descriptor, that description we did to application, with the binaries. So you can get a package which is more or less self-sustained. So that package knows how it should be deployed. It could be built once, it could be uploaded to some, for instance, Maven Artifactory, GitHub release page, whatever. It could be reused multiple times from there as it is versioned and you know exactly what you're getting. And it could be deployed in multiple foundries across the world. So how we can create such a package? Well, not only via the CFCLI, we have an MTA build tool available. It's also open source on GitHub. And again, it is a single command. And it would read that descriptor, and it would assemble such an MTI archive. So now we have that MTI archive. Let's look how a deployment should look like. So I have sped up the demo for you, as such demos are not so magnificent. It's only a single command doing a lot of stuff. But we can see now that the package is being uploaded, then the descriptor is processed, and now backing services are created. Since they are asynchronous, they are created in parallel, so this saves some additional time too. And afterwards, the actual applications get created. You see that the messages there are kind of mixed. That's because the applications are also getting created in parallel and they are staged and started at different times. And at the end, there is a task executed for the database. So that was it for deployment. And what does such a description of our deployment model, such a deployment brings us? So it brings us a management of additional platform entities like service instances, service keys, tasks, brokers, etc. It gives us declarative configurations for such for creation of such entities. You can deploy as many times you like that package. You will always get the same result, as the deployer is always trying to reach the state declared in the descriptor. What else do we have? We have parallel deployment, as you just saw. Yeah. And we have having that description of model, we can do something very interestingly. We can do blue-green deployment not at the scale of a single application, but at the scale of the whole solution. So we can get that descriptor and spin up the whole stack of our application independently from the currently running one. So it would be properly interlinked together. There will be no cross-links between the active version and the new version which is to be deployed. And one is able to test that stack against the productive data. And when one is sure of the quality, again with a single command, one can just hit resume to the process. The routes will be switched, and the old application decommissioned, and you would have update without any downtime of the whole stack. And last but not least, you can expect reproducible results in very varying environments. It doesn't matter if some service instance was created or not, etc., etc. So that wraps it up for Cloud Foundry. Let's see how things look at the land of Kubernetes. So, what are the traits of Kubernetes deployments? Do they have the declarative approach implemented? Pretty much out of the box. Kubernetes supports declarative expressions for all of its entities. Is there parallel execution? Well, since all of the platform entities are created asynchronously, more or less there is a parallel execution. Is there a single common deployment? Well, one can argue that kubectl apply with directory does the same thing, but there is already a member of the community which is doing this and combining all the descriptors in a single, so to say, entity, the Helm chart, and that's Helm. So what my team did is we made a proof of concept how we can port the experience, of the MTAs to Kubernetes. And have in mind that this is a POC and nothing is set in stone, but here is how this would look like. You would get a descriptor of your solution in the language you just saw, and it would be passed to an MTA deployer, as the MTA deployer knows how to speak the language. It would get translated to Kubernetes native entities with more detail, and then passed to Tiwer, the backend component of Helm, or directly to the API server. From there on, those entities will get persisted, and the Kubernetes controllers would take care to asynchronously create them in the platform. So there you would have that solution. And actually, this is how it looks like. This time the demo is not sped up, actually, because it's pretty fast. And to be honest, when you see the success marker at the end, this doesn't mean that everything is created. Currently, it is still created asynchronously by Kubernetes. Of course, this is subject to change. So, yeah, there it is. Everything happening pretty quickly. So let's see what we had to change in the descriptor of our solution in order to achieve this. So there are a couple of things that changed. First of all, we introduced new types of modules. So there is the same MTA model, but since we're modeling entities for a different platform, we introduced new types. And the developer can say, okay, this is a deployment type, or this is a secret, or anything. There is one thing which we did is we separated the lifecycle of the application binaries, the bits, from the descriptor, and we uploaded them basically to a repository, so there is a container image. Hopefully there are already projects in the community, there are projects in the community which bring the build pack experience to Kubernetes, so things might change. And of course, our workloads expected to see the VCAP services environment variable containing references to our descriptor, so we included all the data in the descriptor too. So what this resulted in? This resulted in all those Kubernetes entities, including secrets, application configurations, jobs. Remember that CF task which initiated the database in Kubernetes, it would be a job. In pods, deployments managing those pods, and of course, ingresses and services for the incoming traffic to the application. So to wrap it up about Kubernetes, we use the same abstract descriptor model, the same application workloads, and deploy them on a different platform with different entities. And if I would like to wrap it up for our whole session, my message to you is use declarative deployments, use CF push when appropriate, use CF deploy where you have the case, and do it cross-platform. If you'd like to know more about the MultiApps project, this QR code would lead you to our homepage. You can find us on github.com, and of course you can hit us on Slack with any questions you can have. If there is time for Q&A, as I see, and if not, there's also the office hours right after the break. So, may I have your questions? Yeah, it makes total sense when you have an MTA built just to have a job in concourse which downloads the MTA and deploys it. And it wouldn't be a very big script because you can basically pack the CF CLI inside the container, just reuse it in concourse and just say go. Actually, we are thinking about implementing a concourse resource. So for instance, if you want a job to produce an MTA package, just to give it to the resource and the resource could deploy it. And this would be much effort. Any more questions? Well, if any pop up, from 3:30 to 4:10 we'll be in the big hall and we'll have office hours. Thank you.